Hello and welcome to a very special edition of The English Channel, a little bit of a different one today for you. My name's Ross. If you follow me on any of the social media outlets, you will know that I do a little bit of custom lure painting with an airbrush. And by popular demand, I've actually decided to finally show you guys how I do it, a little bit of a tutorial. So as I go along, I'm probably going to go through all the steps, all the equipment, everything like that. So down there in the comments, I'm just going to put like the different times, and you can jump around as you want to see what I'm doing. So what we're going to be doing today is we're actually going to be painting in Bluegill. This is a this started out as a blank, and it's actually based on a mega bass S-crank. So looks pretty hard, but it's actually super easy. So I'm going to take you through the steps in order to do this. And we're gonna paint something, and hopefully it will catch some fish in the future. All right, stay tuned. All right, first up, we've got our trusty air compressor. These can actually start pretty cheap, and then they can get pretty expensive. What you see here is a dual piston air compressor, and it has a reservoir tank at the bottom. What a reservoir tank does is it actually stores your air in there, so you've always got a constant PSI flowing through your airbrush. If you just have the ones that are just sort of the pistons on top, what will happen is you'll actually start getting bursts of air as that tries to feed your airbrush, because there's nothing holding that air in, it's just constantly trying to make that. So if you're only just getting into it now, you might want to spend a little bit less money, but down the road you're always going to want something with an air reservoir, because that is going to keep that nice steady flow of air. Is what you need. Tons of these on Amazon, all over the internet, so do your research, have a little look. I'm not going to go into it, there's loads of videos out on air compressors, but just showing you what I'm using. All right, let's have a look at the airbrush. All right, probably the most important thing that goes into any type of custom lure painting or airbrushing in general, really, it's going to be your airbrush. Again, these things can start off pretty cheap, at around about 20 US dollars, and they can actually go up well into the hundreds. This one is an Iwata HPC Eclipse. This cost me about $150. I did start off with one of the sort of the lower ones, but trust me when I tell you, when it comes to airbrushing, the more money you spend, the better quality you're gonna get. Just so you know about this one, this is actually a dual action airbrush, all right? And what that means is that I can push down on the button for air, and then also as I pull back, it will increase the paint that's actually coming out of there, so I can actually control the amount of paint, so I can have full air going out at like 30 psi and then just gradually let a little bit of paint out, which is gonna be really good for when I'm doing like detail work. It has this awesome little bit on the back where you can actually you can see when I pull the brush back that actually moves back on that needle that goes through there, and you can actually adjust that so you can have extra control on it. So that's obviously pulling it all the way back full paint, but if you don't want to do that and you want to go a little bit more accurate, then you can just kind of just do like little bursts there, and that's going to stop you. So that's kind of like your brake, which is pretty cool. So Iwata, I don't know how you want to pronounce that, it's a Japanese company, makes some of the best ones on the market, so have a look at them. Again, readily available on Amazon or eBay. One of the other things that I do have on this airbrush here is a quick release. So when I have my hose, what I can do is I can just quickly connect my hose to my air compressor, and off I go to the races, all right? Doesn't get in the way, fits quite nicely in the hand, and then when I want to rinse it out and clean it, I can just quickly, boom, pop it off. The air is held in like that, and I can take out my brush and I can do the washing with it, all right? All right, one of the cool things on the internet that you can get nowadays is blank lures, and they look pretty similar to some of the lures that are out in the market, and some of them probably are a little bit dodgy. There's one guy that I get online from, and he sells really top quality lures, and I mean, this is just the spitting image of an S-crank made by Megabass, which will save you about $25 in the shop. The only difference being this one cost me about $2.50, and I can actually paint it myself to any color scheme that I want, and without blowing my own trumpet, they usually come out a little bit better than Megabass. So the first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna get our lures, all right? Skipping ahead, what I do with all my lures is I actually, I have a white primer, which is just like a Rust-Oleum one. Obviously you wanna not do the, I guess the bill crank, your crank bill, You want to give that clear. Some guys I've seen actually paint that, and I think that's just a bit lazy, because you want to keep that clear so it's keeping that natural form, because obviously when that's in the water, you're not going to be able to see it as easily, aka the fish are going to want to take a bite out of something more that looks like a fish. So this is actually what we're going to be painting today, and we're going to actually come out with something a little bit like that. It's going to be pretty similar. This is not the one that you see at the end of the video. This is the one we're going to paint. This is one I already did. And just to prove that, actually, you can see there's a big chunk out the back from where I cast this towards a concrete bank, and I got the distance wrong and took a chunk out of it. So I'll show you at the end. Let's crack on with this painting business. Right, quickly, just a little rundown of the paints I use and what we'll be using today. Only four colors. All right, so we're going to be using yellow, pearl lime green, I think this is detail orange, and one of the most important ones that you'll find in airbrushing lures is sepia, all right, which is a kind of a brown. Two different types that I do use, two different makes, Vallejo Premium and also Createx Wicked Colors. These are the industry standard in producing your own custom painted lures. They're really, really good for airbrushing, really nice flow to them, and they're also water-based, so you'll actually be able to do them within your house without it stinking, obviously. One last thing is that you want to get some reducer. So obviously to run colors through an airbrush, you need to reduce the thickness of them. Do not use water. I know they're water-based. You're not going to get as good a flow. Get a proper reducer. This is Createx, the guys who make Wicked Colors. Just a couple little drops in your airbrush and it will be flowing nicely coming out your airbrush. So and you'll get a little bit more control from it as well. Okay, so give that a try, bag it, tag it, let's get painting. All right, first things first, we're gonna hit this with some of that yellow. So you can see underneath, we're gonna have yellow all the way along, then we're gonna go to orange, then the green on top and the brown over the top. What you wanna do when you're airbrushing, always start off lightest and then go to your darkest colors. It's much easier. If you're trying to paint light colors, like yellow on top of this, you are never ever gonna get that to go yellow. You're gonna be spraying and spraying and spraying and spraying for hours trying to get that to look the color that you want. So always start dark, always start light and then get darker. All right, so got the bait ready. Always check on a piece of paper how viscous and if it's coming out good. And then we just want to start hitting it with strokes, okay? And what's going to happen is, like, this is going to blend into it. So if you hit it straight on, you're going to get overflow to the sides. And what that's going to do, it's going to just be a nice blend for us. So I'll move this a little back, and let's see if we can get this hit. All right, let's go light coating on there first. And what we wanna do, and something that I use all the time, is a hairdryer. And what you can do with acrylics is you can dry them real quickly, hit it with some air. Which dries it, and then you can get hitting it with another thin layer again. It's all about doing thin layers. You don't wanna goop it on thick, because that's just gonna really not look good. It's gonna run. Coming from both angles, up and down. See how I'm talking about that overflow? It's gonna just gradually go up into it. You just fade it in nicely because you're hitting it there, it kind of like hits it and then fades off. Some of it sticks, and then you get a beautiful, nice little fade into it. Get it nice and easy. All right, hit it again. All right, start hitting this bad boy again. I'm going to use up this whole pot of paint as well. Get nice on there, thick. All That's when my reservoir gets a little low. In order to keep it at the same PSI, it kicks on again. It just keeps us rolling. What's the atmosphere? All right, now you can see I'm out. So let's change colors, going over to orange. All right, quick little tip for you. So we got our paint in there. One way, if you want to mix your paint up with your reducer, you just put your finger over the end and very gently pull the trigger back, and then that will mix it up in there for you. I usually use a paintbrush as well, just to stir it around a bit, get it nice and viscous. And if you're airbrushing, the viscosity you want is somewhere around about 2% milk. That should give you a pretty good viscosity for getting that air through that airbrush. All right, so next bit we're gonna do now, orange at the front. I probably won't go back as much as I did on this one with the orange, but give it that bluegill orange that they have just under their head. Cut, get my flow ready, there we go. And then what I'm gonna do is, because I don't wanna hit all of it with orange, I'm gonna come from this angle here, coming straight across, and what it'll do, it'll blend itself in there. So you can see where it's blending in. And just get a, use that overspray just to get a little bit further back as well. If I don't wanna go further back, then I can come from a steeper angle. Alright, we're gonna use a little bit of hot air. Cool. And I'm gonna use a little bit, I'm not gonna pull back on my trigger as much, I just wanna get a little bit of paint in here. A little bit more paint in here. A little overspray. Blend it nicely in with that yellow. There we go, it's looking good. That is all right. Let's move to green. All right, now we're gonna lay some green down onto this bad boy. All right, so we've got our yellow nicely blended into our orange there. Doesn't look much like a bluegill yet, but trust me, it's all gonna come out nicely soon. All right, but those colors are looking nice. So what we're gonna do now is we're gonna hit this with some green. All right, like I mentioned at the beginning, we're gonna be using some lime green. Pearl lime green, which you probably think, oh, it's a little bit too dark for that, but that is going to be the magic of the sepia. When you're airbrushing, it's all about your layering, and the colors that are underneath of the ones that you're spraying are going to dictate what is on top and be most predominant. So here's my lime green. All right, like I said, doesn't look much like a bluegill, doesn't look like the top, does it? But that will all become evident very shortly. So let's hit this bit of green, and what we're going to try and do is just fill in all the white bits and then blend it nicely down. So we're going to hit it straight on and use that overspray to blend it in for us. It does all the work for us. And then gradually work around the sides, use that overspray. See how it's starting to blend in there? Can't even tell. Looks like a professional did it. Didn't even try. When you're blending, always do try and use the angles, because if you go straight on, it's just going to hit it and it's just going to go everywhere. So even if it's just a little bit of an angle, it's coming through here and diverting off. You want to hit it so it just goes there and splashes against it. Also, make sure you get the beak in there. Nice. All right, hit it with the hairdryer. good. As soon as you start to see that like glistening, that's when you know it's getting pretty wet. That's when you know you want to hit it again, a bit more of hairdryer. Get that first, or second coat in this case, set. Not bad, folks. Not bad at all. All right, folks, there's going to be three parts, I guess, to this next color, which is sepia. Like I said, it's a brown. You could use black, but one thing I do remember from art school when I was a kid is my art teacher told me never to darken colors with black. Always try and use the opposite end or opposite of the scale of the color table, or it mix in a little bit of brown, makes it look much more natural. So I'm going to be using sepia, and we're going to get going on that. So the first thing I'm going to do is I've got this fabric, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to put this fabric, I'll jump to it in a second, put it over the top, and that's going to be so we can get some nice detail on the scales. All right, so we got that mesh on here that's going to act as our scales. All right, what we're going to do is we're only going to do a very, very light spraying of it, because what's going to happen is when we take that off, that's still going to be there, and we're actually going to be hitting it again just to darken everything out and bring it all together. And what will happen is as you spray more brown or the sepia onto those spots that we've done already, they will actually get darker. So that's what I was talking about with layering. So you got to kind of think a couple layers ahead when you're airbrushing, all right? So let's get some paint on this. Just a very light layer is all we want. All right, that'll do. Alright, that will do. Alright, big unveil. Alright. And there you go. And you might be thinking, what the hell is that? And believe me, it'll all come together in a minute. Alright. Next stage. What we want to do are those diagonal lines, or sorry, not diagonals, those vertical lines going down the body itself. So what we use for that is a simple, I guess, what would it be, a hairpin or a hairbrush? I don't know what these things are called. And what we can do is we can just simply lay that over the top, and again, just hit it again with a very light spray. And then we can take that off, and then what we'll do is we'll bring in the rest of the sepia, just hit it like it is, and just fill in those gaps and make it look much more natural looking. All right, this bit can be a little bit fiddly. Just gonna put that there. It's hard to get it because it's not exactly flat. You can get one I've used before. All right, this is one that I flattened out a little bit before. Hopefully it'll fit to it a little bit better. Might get my hands a little bit painty here, but whatever, all right. And then just a couple light layers. Try and get the lines. And there we go. That's one side. Let's get that cured quickly. And then we're just going to do the same on the other side. This is going to be hard because I'm going to have to cross my hands over. All right. Okay, just a couple sprays. All go. Alright, sweet. Looking good. Alright, now what we can do, it's going to blend all that in together. Because like I said, once we get that second layer of brown on here, that's just going to bring, it's going to color in the gaps here, and it's actually going to make those bits that we've done brown already, or sepia, bring them nicely together and make them darker. Alright, so, let's get that there, work. Alright, and then again, I'm just going to do nice, light layers here, just bring it all together, try and not go too brown because we want to keep that green. And as you can see, they get darker. Brown stays, the green stays. And you get a much more natural looking bait. Pretty cool. Like that, like it a lot. I'm gonna leave the nose green, I like that. A little bit of change. Maybe one more little spray on the back. Bring that scales just a little bit in. Cool. He's a good one. Right, so as you can see, we are now starting to get into that bluegill zone. All right, I did lie a little bit at the beginning. I did say we're just using the four colors. We do have a little bit of detail work to do. That's just going to be the blue of the scales and then the little black dot that they have just above their ears, or their markings that we're going to put on there, and then we should be good to go with the eyes and finishing. So I'm just going to tape off the gills here, and then we'll be good to spray the blue. All right, we got a little blue gill all masked up. So what I'm gonna try and do is I'm just gonna try and keep the blue at the bottom of the gills. If you look at a blue gill, they usually just have it right underneath. They don't have it all over. I've downed the PSI pressure on my air compressor. I've downed the air PSI on my air compressor and I've set my airbrush so it can't let a lot of paint out. So I'm gonna do a little bit of detail work here. All right, so I'm gonna let some air out, and then every now and then I'm just gonna let a little bit of blue, and you can see it gradually coming. And this is how you get your detail work with an airbrush. Yes, yep, still coming out. Because it's coming out so thin as well, as it hits that, it's pretty much drying instantly because I've got so much air coming out, just a little bit of paint. So you can be pretty liberal as you go on with these. You don't have to use the old hairdryer so much. Oh, I'm liking that. I think that's good. All right, let's do the other side. Now, a good thing about all nature is nothing in nature is symmetrical. So we want to get the side kind of similar, but it doesn't matter if it's not matching completely, because like I said, nothing in nature is completely symmetrical. So again, I'm just gonna hit these bits here, maybe get a bit more paint coming out. All right, that's good. Get more paint this time. Controlling that paint, you can see my finger moving back just a little bit, just to let a bit more paint out at a time. I think we're good there. I think that's gonna be good. That's going to be good. Right, cool thing about masking, I always love taking off because it looks awesome when you take it off. Let's get this bit here. Try not to take off any of the paint as well. You've got to be careful because it's still not completely cured. Let's go down here. Look at that. Beautiful. Cool, look at that. All right, looking like a bluegill. So all I'm gonna do now is just a little bit of black and do the little dots above the blue. All right, folks, so moving on to the very last stage. I'm just gonna do those little black dots that are just above the eye there. I'm gonna freehand this. When I started doing them, I used to use a stencil, but you don't really need a stencil anymore if you get the hang of an airbrush, so. I'm going to spray mostly onto the, actually use this as kind of like a palette almost, and just use that to kind of go in and out and just build that little black spot. Like that. See that? Stay in focus, you bastard. There you go. So, it's the black done. Take that off. There you go, just above the eye. It's pretty sweet. Liking that. And let's do it on this side as well. Try and give you guys a good angle as well. Get a bit more black coming out of that. Let's try again. Sometimes when you're doing such little paint coming out, it will like not clog up, but you just need to kind of like blow some more air through it at higher PSI. Okay, that'll work. Let me just take that off. Et voila. You have yourselves a bluegill. Looking pretty sweet. All right, so yeah, a couple finishing touches now. This is the one I showed you earlier on. We're gonna go put some eyes in there. I'll take you through that. And then I'll also take you through this nice, glossy, shiny finish as well. All right, so a little bit of finishing now. So I've just put this on like a little soft chamois cloth. I use it for like waxing my car and stuff, but it means it's not gonna scratch the paint. We're gonna get some eyes on here. All right, so these you can get dime a dozen. Different colors, different sizes. I tend to like sort of like the more orangey ones. I guess with a bluegill, you probably want to match it up a little bit. What did I use on the other one? It was a bit of a different one. That was like an old Megabass one, but I think we'll go with the, let's just go with the clear, because that's kind of like a nice cool rainbow color, and I think in the water that will kind of like glimmer off a little bit. These are a royal pain in the butt to get onto there. So I use my trusty tweezers, and you will see, like, you probably won't be able to see, but the black pupils are actually shaped. They're not just set perfectly round, so you kind of, I mean, I guess it's a little bit OCD, but I like to get them properly aligned and looking the same. Oop. And so it begins. All right, I'm just gonna go use your finger a little bit because it always sticks to your tweezers. There you go, there's one. So we have the front bit of the bottom. Okay, cool. There you go. I like the eyes because that always brings your fish to life, doesn't it? See? It's looking pretty sweet, I've got to say. Pretty simple stuff, all right? And then now we can just get on to finishing. All right, final step, folks. All right, so now that you've got that lovely paint job on there, you don't want to mess that up. So what a lot of lure guys will use is clear epoxy, because it dries like glass and is hard as nails. All right, so stuff I use is this, Devcon 2-ton epoxy. It's absolutely clear. Some epoxies you'll see, one is kind of like more of a yellow. This stuff is completely crystal clear and will dry clear, and it is super, super strong, super hard, and it will protect your bait. All right, so the way I'm gonna put this on, I usually keep my lids. This is from Banana Peppers, and you can use these a couple times. And then just a regular sort of like artist paintbrush. These you can use time and time again. You might think brushing on epoxy is gonna ruin it. As long as you get it into some acetone very quickly after brushing it, then it will look after your brushes as well. All right, so when I'm cleaning that, I actually just use acetone, and I take it straight to the, a little bit of dish liquid on there, and that gets it back to usable again. All right, it can be quite a messy process. So what I'm gonna do to start with is I'm gonna take this masking tape off, because when you've got epoxy all over there, it gets super messy and you might mess up your job of getting the epoxy on there. So I'm gonna take all this off. If I have a little bit of overspill, it's gonna be clear, and it's clear underneath anyway. So 2 seconds. All right, I'm gonna get a little bit of our epoxy. Let's see, it's messy already. Get some of that. You want equal amounts, make sure you get equal amounts, because otherwise, if you haven't used epoxy before, it's gonna stay tacky for the rest of your life. All right. So that should be just about enough. And then what I use is I just use nail, mix that up. You don't use the brush, get excess off there. Brilliant. And then, right, so you want to be quite liberal, right? So you'll see, and the beautiful thing about epoxy, it's self-leveling. So you're not going to get more thick bits in one place than the other. It's going to be nice and self-loathing, nice and self-leveling. So nice big bit on the brush to start with. I always start across the eyes, and that's the other beautiful thing. It's going to glue that eye right into place, so the eye is not going to come out. And nice, easy brush strokes. You might get a little bit onto that bill. It doesn't matter. And underneath. See, that's nice and heavily on there. Brushes on beautifully. Do want to be liberal with this stuff, because you do want it on there thick. You don't want it so it's going to be running all over the joint, but you do want it on there thick. As I said, it all blends together and then it dries completely even, which is awesome. Whoever came up with this idea was a friggin' genius. And just look over it. You can see when you've missed bits, because it will look kind of like there's a spot missing. Like it will look dry and look like it's depressed into the into your job. And there, I think we go. That looks all right, doesn't it? All right, so now I won't be touching this again until tomorrow. If you did do it in the morning, you could grab it by the evening. But as far as airbrushing your bluegills goes, you're done. Slam some hooks on there, jobs are getting. I think that even turned out better than my other one, to be honest with you. That was my original, which I did have to chunk out of because I hit it with concrete against a wall. That time I used a little bit of a different stencil on top, and I'm liking that a lot more. Pretty cool, eh? Anyway, give that a go. All right, guys, thank you very much for watching that little painting session. I know a lot of you have been asking me to do that for a while, so I hope that answered some of your questions. If you do have any questions, slam them down in the comments for me. I'll be happy to answer them for you. But hopefully, you know, you can get some stuff painted on your own and catch some fish with them. It's pretty cool when you start catching fish on stuff that you've painted yourself. And like I said, you know, $2.50 for a blank, a little bit of effort. I enjoy doing it. It's good, it's, you know, good psychotherapy as well. So, you know, I tend to just paint my own baits now. So Whatever you do, good luck with it. Leave us a comment. Do stick a subscribe on there, because I'm probably going to do a little bit more painting in the future. Probably next time I'm going to be looking at doing a sexy shad, which is going to be even easier than this one. And this one was easy. So until next time, hope your lines are tight. Fish on.